Shalom, family. The soul food topic on tonight is hush, ladies. The topic is hush, ladies. Because in the Christian church, you know, the belief is that women have been given the authority and have been given the power, the liberty to act as men, to be preachers, to be teachers, to be leaders over congregations and assemblies. And they have distorted and perverted the laws of God and have gone astray. And if you watch TBN or any of the Christian stations, you'll see that the woman, especially the black woman, is out in front leading the Christian movement. Okay. And you see all manner of disorder and disharmony within our community because of that. Okay. Usually the black man has removed himself from the black church, but the black woman remains there, a congregation of a lot of women and effeminate men. Okay, we see this in our communities. We see this in the black church or in the church as a whole, even in white churches. Okay, but this lesson is about the woman needing to be quiet. Hush, ladies. Okay, so we're going to get right into the topic. Jonathan, can you give me the book of Galatians chapter 3 and verse 28? The book of Galatians chapter 3 and verse 28. Book of Galatians, chapter 3, and verse 28. Come on. Chopping that sword, brother.
Wait, 16 and 78, you said?
No.
What did you say?
The book of Galatians, chapter 3, and verse 28.
There is neither Jew nor
Greek, it says Greek in the King James.
Salakia. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female.
Hold it right there. Hold it right there. This is the mantra for the black woman or for the feminist movement within the Christian church. There is neither male nor female. We're going to focus on that. Now, the Jew and Greek, that's a whole nother argument that the apologetics like to get into and argue concerning Paul's epistles. But for tonight, we're dealing with that aspect of it, okay? There is neither male nor female, okay? Read on.
There is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Jesus Christ.
You're all one in Christ. You're all one in Yahawashi. There is neither male nor female. The distortion of this scripture is to tell you that male and female are viewed the very same and that we are genderless before God. That's the perversion of this scripture, of this passage. But as we go through the lesson, we're going to see that that is not so. The writer is giving a very specific teaching here. It's not saying that there's no longer male and female and that we're genderless, we're gender neutral. Okay, or to say that the traditional roles and view of man and woman have now gone out the window because Christ said that the man can do like the woman can do and the woman can do like the man can do. You're all one. You don't have to be pinholed to what a man says you have to do or the way society says a woman. You can be whatever you want to be in Jesus. That's what the Christian church teaches. That's how they pervert the scripture. But we're going to deal with it tonight, okay? From there, Gail, can you grab me the book of 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 7? The book of 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 7. There's neither male nor female, but we are all one in Christ Jesus.
1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered.
Okay, so now you're seeing Peter speak to married couples, husband and wives, who are joined together in matrimony and have become one, right? Have become a union, right? He's speaking to that couple. And he's saying that they're both heirs together of the grace of life, right? But you see, even as Peter is defining with the husband and the wife, that there is a status, that there is a hierarchy. There is a difference between the husband and the wife. They're not the same, but he says that the wife is the weaker vessel. Okay? So this right here, this passage right here helps to clarify a little bit what Paul was talking about in the book of Galatians. That ye are one in Christ Jesus. It's talking about being heirs together of the grace, meaning that you are one in the pursuit of righteousness and the eternal gain of eternal life. That's what it's talking about. Okay? And furthermore, that a man and a woman can both be used of God and be used of the Spirit to bring about a righteous cause. But it's not saying that the authority that has been given to the man and the submissive order that has been placed on the woman is now done away with. A man don't have to be submissive to a woman. I'm sorry. A woman doesn't have to be submissive to a man anymore. That's what the Christian church teaches. But let's go on. Gail, can you grab me the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 5? The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 5. So I first want to illustrate throughout scripture the fact that the Most High God can use women, right? Has and will use women for his purpose and for his will, right? Where women, when they were in submission to the Most High God and moved in a righteous manner, performed great works. Okay? They performed great works. So go ahead and read 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 5.
But every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered dishonoreth her head. For that is even all one as if she were shaven.
Okay? So we see here that women prophesy. Not only pray, but prophesy. But the commandment is saying that their head be covered when they pray or when they prophesy. Okay? So, with the title being Hush, Ladies, is not to say that women have no place to ever speak, but that women need to learn that they ought to remain silent for most of the time. There is a time for women to speak, and then there's a time for the women to sit down and be quiet. The same thing applies to a man. But the problem is the women have run rampant. The Christian woman has been liberated by her Christian pastor to pursue evangelism, to pursue the bishopric, to pursue all manner of ministry, right? To be out in front. This is the type of conversation that especially black women like to have in the Christian church. They want to get out there. They got to, quote unquote, stir up the gift. Right? They go to each of the churches and go through the gospel circuits. And, you know, they want to get out, whether they can sing a little bit, they want to sing and, you know, fuse that with their teaching or preaching ability. And they want some bishop to come and christen them and put them out there just the way Salakia, that T.D. Jakes did to Paula White and Juanita Bynum. He said, these are my two leading ladies. They're my stars. Got the white one and the black one. The white one, huh, what'd you say? No, that's just what he did. The white one, she act black, so I could kind of use her to cross over between the white audience and the black audience. And then Juanita Bynum, all the black women just, man, I love Juanita Bynum. What's the lesson she had? The groundbreaking lesson that she had back in the day, late 90s, early 2000s. What was it? In the Sheets or something?
Oh, yeah.
What was it called?
I can't remember. I had it, though.
Something in the Sheets. Some crazy lesson. You know what I'm saying? But it's women like her, right? Name a few. Joyce Meyer. Vicky Winans to a lesser degree. You know, Shirley Caesar. A lot of these women, this movement. Who was the white woman in the 70s that would go and do revivals
Catherine
around the...
Coleman.
Catherine Kuhlman?
Yeah.
Yeah, and she was like a Pentecostal, right? She's charismatic and,
like,
you know,
Benny
like a Hinn. Like Benny Hinn, a healer, and tried to act black too. And had a lot of black people, white and black, you know, that Pentecostal kind of, you know, atmosphere and stirring the people up. But that was that feminist movement that was started in such a time and just continued to grow and grow and grow and grow and grow. So now when you go into the Christian church, especially the black Christian church, is filled with women. Filled with women. Women pastors. Women on the, what's it called? The at the altar. What's, like, when you sit behind the pastor, what's that called? Come on, man. I act like you don't know what I'm talking about.
I don't know.
No, just...
The pulpit?
Yeah, in the pulpit.
Oh.
Thank you. Thank you, Jonathan. In the pulpit. So you got a lot of women up there. You got women that's ushers. You got women in the pew. What? Yeah, but I'm saying, yeah, as the bishop, as the minister, evangelist, whatever. You got all the women in the pews, right? Women, 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 women. And if there are any men in there, right, these women are... The men are submissive to the women, right? You've heard men say that in the past, that they'd rather be up under a woman pastor than they would a man pastor.
Yeah.
Okay? So this is what's destroying our community, because no one has told the woman, especially the black woman, to be quiet. She's been given liberty by the distortion of scripture to run her mouth and say whatever comes to her heart. But she a false prophet. Okay? So you read 1 Corinthians 11 and 5, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now I would like you to move on to chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians and read verses 29 through 33. The book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 14, verses 29 through 33. Yep. Now, before you read that, remember we just read in 1 Corinthians 11 and 5 that if a woman pray or prophesy, let her head be covered, right? So she bring not shame unto herself or to her head, right? So we know that women can prophesy. So as we read this scripture, this next scripture, let's realize that it's not exclusive to the man, but it's also encompassing men and women, because both men and women can prophesy.
I'm sorry.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 29.
Chapter 14.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
29 through 33. Ready?
Just say it one more time.
1 Corinthians chapter 14, 29 through 33. Let the prophet speak two or three, and let the other judge.
Salakia. So we're seeing here that Apostle Paul put in righteousness a sort of check and balances within the church, within the assembly, right? I don't know about any of you, but for myself, I've been in church services where people just get up and feel moved by the Spirit and just start saying stuff. And no one ever checks them or stops them or kind of, you know, causes them to yield to the authority of the church. They just open their mouth and start talking. But right here is saying in verse 29, let the prophet speak two or three, meaning there shouldn't be seven people saying, I got a word from the Lord. Two or three at the most today is going to speak. And let the other judge, not just listen, but judge the matter. There would be times in my past where I would be just a kid in church, not really know what's going on. Women jumping up, feeling like she got a testimony or the Spirit is moving on her. So she's talking. The authority of the church, whether it be man or woman, didn't make her yield to their authority. She's just talking, and there is no other prophet or godly individual to judge the matter. They're just talking and saying whatever. And if it sounds good enough, the church will clap or praise the Lord or whatever. But there's supposed to be checks and balances. You don't just get to get up and say, hey, I got something from the Lord. I want to give my prophecy. and everyone just listen and clap and applaud. There's supposed to be checks and balances. That if you're given place and say, go ahead, prophesy. And they're prophesying and it sounds contradictory to the scripture, to the laws of God, and say, shut your mouth. You are speaking falsehood. You can see that in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 28, where Jeremiah withstood Hananiah. Because the word of the Lord spoke unto Jeremiah and gave him the word of prophecy. Hananiah was speaking according to the flesh. He was manufacturing his own word, right? But the people were more inclined to listen to Hananiah. And Jeremiah had to rebuke him. So when Paul is bringing this out in 1 Corinthians, you're seeing the precedent in the Old Testament. You're seeing that precedent. Jeremiah had to check him, bruh. That's not according to the word of the Most High God. You making up your own thing, bruh. Nah, no, I'm not. God said this. This is the prophecy right here. And the people's like, well, it sound all right. And he was judged because he was lying on the Most High God. But this is the error of the Christian church. The woman is allowed to open her mouth at any given time throughout the course of the service and declare whatever word she want to declare. Get up and start laying hands on people and just do. And the pastor, male or female, won't say anything. Just feel like the spirit is moving, right? The spirit is just moving. She just getting up and touching people with her filthy, nasty hand. Probably was fornicating the night before. Just laying her hands on everybody and spitting and spraying and praise God and speaking in some unknown tongue. There's no checks and balances. There's no one telling her to be quiet, sit down, and let me hear the matter. Let me judge it according to the Bible. Okay, but read on.
If anything be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace.
So that, again, going along with the checks and balances. So if the woman get up and start running her mouth, right, and the Spirit of God speaks unto a true man of God, and he begins to have the revelation that what she's saying is in error, then when he declares the word, and it could be another woman. The Most High can use another woman to rebuke the first woman. But the thing is, the first woman got to shut her mouth and be quiet because now the Spirit of God is truly speaking. This man or this woman now who is speaking is the true oracle of God, not the first one. Okay? And it may not even be that the first person is wrong, but the Most High God could be bringing an updated revelation, if you will. An updated revelation. Think about the story with the prophet Isaiah and Hezekiah, right? When Isaiah came to bring the judgment to King Hezekiah, he knew that his death was imminent, right? But as soon as Isaiah left Hezekiah's presence, Hezekiah turned his face towards the wall and began to pray and make supplication to God and repent of his sins. And as Isaiah is walking out of the palace and into the courtyard, the Spirit of God spoke to Isaiah and said, turn around and go back and prophesy and say, I've heard thy prayer. So Isaiah got an immediate update on the prophecy. And so, okay, let me turn around and go give him the rest of this prophecy. And I'm going to add 15 years to your life because I heard your cry and that you submitted yourself to me. Okay? But you're seeing there's checks and balances. Read on.
Verse 31, for ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may hear, and all may be comforted. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets.
Read that again.
And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets.
Salakia, Jonathan, what do you think that mean?
That some people are chosen to be prophets. You know, not everybody is chosen to be a prophet. And, yeah, well, to me, that's kind of what it means to me, that everybody is not chosen to be a prophet. Some people have that spirit of being a prophet. Everybody doesn't, though.
Partly. But more so what it's saying, if you have, because it said two or three at one time. So if it's this, say, for instance, you got three prophets, true men or women, prophetesses of God's there. The prophets must be subject to the spirit of the prophet. So just as the verse above says, if anything be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. That's the prophet being subject to the spirit of the prophet. Because it's not you, If the prophecy is uttered out of your mouth or out of your mouth or out of my mouth, it's not us individually that's so deep and so revelational that we're bringing or manifesting something from some inner. No, it's the Spirit of God that's speaking through you, speaking through you, or speaking through me. So when it's saying being subject to the spirit of the prophets, that truly is meaning being subject to the Holy Ghost, who's speaking through whoever vessel he chooses to speak at that moment. So if the brother say, brother, I'm getting a word right now. No, brother, let me finish what I'm saying, because God. No, you need to be subject to the spirit of the prophets. Okay. Read on.
Verse 33. For Yahweh is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints.
Okay. So as you read on past verse 33, it's going to start getting into the women, but we're going to leave that a little for later on. Okay. Let's see. Jonathan, can you grab me the book of Genesis, chapter 21 and verse 12? We're still dealing with the woman and how the Most High God can use her. I want to bring these scriptures out first to show you how a woman can be used and the manner in which the Most High God will use a woman. Okay? Before I reprove and start correcting them, I want to start just to bring out that God can use the woman. There is a purpose. There is a calling for the women. But you got to walk upright and do the will of God and not be perverse in your deeds. Okay? So go ahead and read what you got.
And God said to Abraham, let it not be grievous in your sight because of the lad and because of your bondwoman and all that Sarah has said unto you. Hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall your seed be called.
Wow. Wow. So what we're seeing here in the book of Genesis is that Sarah, Abraham's wife, was upset and distraught by the dealings of Hagar, her handmaiden, and how she treated her with the birth of her son Isaac from her husband Abraham. She was very upset, and she came to her husband and said, look, babe, you're going to have to put her away, her and her son, right? Because I'm not feeling this at all. You got to put her away. And Abraham like, come on now. What are you? This is my son. I'm not hearing that. You need to get her out of here. This girl flexing like she run the place. You need to get rid of her. Right? And Abraham was grieved. The scripture said he was grieved about this. Like, what? You putting me between a rock and a hard place. What you talking about? Get rid of my son? Are you mad? But the angel of God came to Abraham. The angel of God came and presented himself in his glorious apparel and spoke unto Father Abraham. He did not tell him, do what thou seemest right, O Abraham. He didn't say, Abraham, rebuke thy wife, O Abraham. No, but he said, Abraham, hearken unto the voice of thy wife. The scripture calls the wife the weaker vessel. So the angel of God, the commandment of God, was that Abraham, the authority and ruler of his home and his estate, was to hearken and obey the voice of his wife. This was from the Most High God. Okay? But women will take instances like this and make this the foundation of how things ought to be. Women right now, even outside of the Christian church, are fighting for being able to run their relationships, right? You see this in different YouTube videos or podcasts or whatever, when men and women, especially black men and black women, are discussing relationships and the role the man's supposed to play as opposed to the woman. And the woman in her view is like, you know, I make this amount of money, or I expect a man to make this amount of money and take care of me and do this and that. And I want to do, and this is like the woman is fighting for this. And a lot of times she's getting this. She gets the authority, she gets the power, she gets the man to, you know, yield to her. And a lot of times she's still not happy. She's still not happy. A lot of women will get a man to submit to her. And guess what happens? She'll leave that man or cheat on that man, Shalakia, for another man who didn't bow to her. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So the man is bowing to you because that's what you say you want. But then you find he's a lame. He whack. I don't want to be with him. He a simp. And so you leave the very man that you conform to your image to go get with the man that you're supposed to be submitting to. So this feminist movement is being pushed, but these women don't even want that junk. They realize that it's profitless. There's nothing in it. They just end up alone. They can have a good career and making a lot of money, have a lot of sex. And then when their thing is dried out and don't nobody want them, and the makeup is not hiding your hideous looks, then you want to settle down and try to submit. But usually by that, you're already a reed that is hardened in her ways. You got a harlot's mentality trying to put on the apparel of a housewife. So now you pushing 40 or plus 40, wanting to settle down and find a man, and you think that you trying to be a wife and the mold that you are is acceptable, that a man wants that. You got 6 kids, been in relationships before, you're still not submissive, and you think some man wants you? You need to learn how to be quiet. Okay? But you see here in Genesis 21 and 12 that the commandment of God was for Abraham to obey his wife. Gail, can you grab me 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1, 5, and 6? Jonathan, can you give me Exodus 15 and hold it? So that was 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1, 5, and 6.
Okay, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1. Likewise, ye wives, be in submission to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives.
Shalakia, so the submission of a wife to her husband isn't just for that union. That's what wives need to understand. Your submission and your humility to your husband is not simply for your own marriage and union, right? Just to bring peace to your husband. But your example is supposed to shine forth so that other women see it and learn of what to do in a relationship, in a marriage. If they don't see your godly example, then the women will be led astray, being led of the societal teachings of what it means to be a woman and what it means to be a wife by society. But when a woman, a young lady in this society, sees an older woman and conduct herself in a godly, submissive way to her husband, she can see that. Okay? Read on.
Verse 5 and 6. For after this manner in the old time, the holy women also, who trusted in Yahweh, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands, even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him master, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement.
Okay. So we read in Genesis that the commandment was for Abraham to obey Sarah, but not permanently. It was just on that one instance. Okay, but Peter is bringing out the fact that Sarah, her mission was to obey her master, to obey her lord, if you will, her husband. Okay, and this is what he's teaching all the women to do, to be submissive. What does the scripture say? Be in subjection unto their own husbands. That's the problem in the Christian church, because you got black women who are in those churches and they submit themselves to another man that's not their husband. Bishop Porkchop, she'll submit to him, but because her husband don't want to be in the church and he'd rather be home watching football on Sunday, she won't submit to him. But every time the church opened, she run into Bishop Porkchop to do whatever he asked her to do. Sister so-and-so, can you clean the bathrooms on Saturday? Yes, Bishop Porkchop. But when your husband asks you to do something because he's not a man of God, you don't feel like you have to obey him. Yes, you wanted to say something?
Yes, not just that. They won't clean their own home, but they'll go and clean up what the bishop tells them to clean up.
Exactly.
Not their homes for their husbands.
So the scripture is saying be in subjection to their own husband, not somebody else's husband, not the first lady's husband, mm-hmm. but your own husband, right? And then saying partnering that scripture with the next scripture, which says of how Sarah did it with Abraham. So this was her lifestyle. She obeyed her husband and was in subjection to her husband. And that's why she was a blessed woman. In Genesis, it says that she shall bring forth nations as well. Sarah was a blessed woman because she obeyed God through the serving of her husband. But there was one instance where the Most High God told Abraham to listen to Sarah. Okay. Jonathan, can you read Exodus chapter 15 and verse 20?
And Miriam the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, slipped a timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dances.
So Miriam, the elder sister of Moses, also was a prophet or a prophetess. Okay. So that's all I wanted there. Can you grab me, Gail, Luke? Chapter 1, verse 41 and 42. The book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 41 and 42.
I thought you meant winner, like W-I-N-N-E-R. Like, that's why I'm a winner.
Luke, chapter 1, verses 41 and 42. And it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. And she spake out with a loud voice and said, Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb.
So Miriam was a prophetess, and Elizabeth prophesied. She was filled with the Holy Ghost. The Most High God used her to bring forth a message to her cousin. Okay. Jonathan, can you grab me the book of Judges, chapter 4, verse 4? And Gail, you stay in Luke, chapter 2. The book of Judges, chapter 4, verse 4.
And Deborah the prophetess, the woman of Lapidoth, she judged Israel at that time.
Okay. So that's two prophetesses, right? You got Miriam and you got Deborah, right? Let's bring on another one. Gail, grab me the book of Luke, chapter 2, verse 36. The book of Luke, chapter 2 and verse 36.
And there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age and had lived with an husband 7 years from her virginity.
Okay. These are three prophetesses that we're bringing out in scripture. Three of them, as well as Elizabeth, who did not have the office of a prophetess, but who did prophesy, and the Spirit of God fell upon her. Okay? So those are four women, three who had a full office of prophet. Right? Let's bring out some more. Jonathan, can you grab me the book of 2 Kings, chapter 22 and verse 14? These weren't soothsayers. These weren't witches. These weren't women who were working in divination. Right? But these were women who were godly and received revelation of God as the Spirit willed, not as the woman willed. Not to say, you know, I feel a word. I feel something coming on because she's moving in emotion. Because a lot of women like to, especially in the Christian church, they move on emotion. God is not saying anything. 9 times out of 10, God is not saying anything in those Christian churches. But she always got something to say. Ain't that crazy? God ain't say nothing, but the black woman got a whole lot to say in the church. Okay, but these women here that are being mentioned were not soothsayers. They didn't look into their crystal ball. Or as the scripture talk about, pillows in the armpits and all that, and you hunt for heads and stuff like that, the witches of the day, King Saul went into the witch of Endor, right? And she looked into her crystal ball and she conjured stuff and she summoned the spirit to speak. Yeah, women can get into that. A lot of our women are getting into witchcraft. But these godly women, Anna and Miriam and Deborah and Elizabeth, these were women that submitted unto God and gave themselves unto fasting and prayer and supplication, sackcloth and ashes, and prayed on behalf of her people, who gave alms, who were holy women. Who kept the commandments of God.
Hallelujah.
And half of them were married to husbands and submitted to their husbands as the law saith. In Anna's case, she was a widow. She didn't even want to have sex no more. This woman was a godly woman, not no witch. Mm-hmm. Putting gumbo in the cauldron. And you know, making up spells and incantations. Oh my, none of that junk. None of that garbage. These were godly women who received revelation from on high, just like the male prophets. These female prophetesses were receiving the spirit as well. So then why is the lesson called Hush, Ladies? Because the women need to shut up. The false speakers, the one who don't need to be talking, they need to be quiet. So go ahead and read what you got. 2 Kings chapter 22 and 14. You almost finished.
How do you pronounce her name?
So Hilkiah
the priest and Akiquim and Akbar and Shephem and Isaiah went into Huldah, the prophetess, the woman of Shalom, the son of Tivka, the son of Karkat, guarder of the wardrobe. Now she dwelt in Jerusalem in the college, and they communed with her. So
I know you
butchered the name.
Set me up.
But what I want you to see here, I want you to try to imagine, if you will. This is the time of the Reformation with King Josiah, a very righteous man, who when Shaphan the scribe? When he brought forth the book, he found the book in the temple and brought it to Hilkiah the priest, right? No, I'm sorry. Hilkiah the priest found the book and brought it to Shaphan, and he read it in the presence of the king, right? The king was moved. He was compelled to repent and bring about righteous reformation in the land of Israel, in the cities of Judah, right? But before he went... Okay, so as King Josiah rent his clothes and realized that a change needed to happen, right? His first order of business, I want you to see what took place here in verse 14. Hilkiah the priest and all these other men, Shaphan as well, all of these great nobles in the king's cabinet, if you will, or administration or palace, they all went to this woman. Not a witch, though. Not a soothsayer, but they all went to this woman, Huldah, the prophetess. She was renowned in the land as a woman of God. She was renowned. It even says in parentheses, now she dwelt in Jerusalem in the college. The college? You mean like a university? You mean like one where you got to pay tuition? No. College meaning, let me see if I can look here. Bear with me, you guys. I want to look up that word in the Hebrew. Let me look it up. Let me look it up. Where we at? Bear with me. So we're going to look at the Hebrew word. For real? For real? It's not loading all of a sudden. What were you going to say? You got a word? Is it there a word there?
It's not really a word, but it says that in the colleges, in the second part, so maybe within the synagogue and the temple, second part.
It's crazy that that's not loading up. But college, it's referring to the assembly of prophets, okay?
Within the synagogue.
Within a synagogue, within an assembly. So when it's talking about colleges, this woman was an oracle or an aid to either other prophetesses or other prophets. This woman was highly renowned. She dwelt among the college of prophets in Jerusalem. And the king and all of the righteous men knew of her. She had a great reputation. Okay? To dwell in the college of prophets is like, what is that like? That's like, if we think about a normal college, right? If you wanted to get understanding on engineering, right? And you know that there was a university that had, you know, their own facility and faculty of engineers, you could go to that university and sit down and speak to a myriad of professors and professionals who are mastered in engineering, architecture, and all manner of machinery and all types of knowledge. You could sit down with, it's like your 25 guys who could have over 100 years of training and expertise in a particular field. And they went to this college, and out of all these prophets and prophetesses, Huldah stood out. Out of all these intellectual minds at a university, a modern day university, you can pick the brains and say, man, they're all smart, but this guy right here or this one right here, they're really sharp. Huldah, she stood out among all of these prophets and prophetesses. That's why all of these kingly men came and sat down around her. But listen to what was said here in verse 14. And went into Huldah the prophetess, the wife of Shallum, the son of Tikva, the son of Harhas, the keeper of the wardrobe. So this woman was highly renowned as a prophetess, but her husband, from all accounts, was a pretty meager or humble man, meaning he didn't have a high position. But she was still married, and guess what? According to the commandment, according to how Sarah conducted herself, this woman still had to be submissive to her husband. We could look at it as Shulam worked at McDonald's, and his wife was an anointed woman of God. She still had to be submissive to him, as the commandment says. So for all the Christian women that want to say Deborah was just flowing and doing her thing and just causing miracles to happen because she was just a godly woman, no. Deborah was married, and Deborah had to submit to her husband, just as Huldah had to submit to her husband, even being a greatly renowned prophetess. The men of God, the kingly council, came down out from their palace to seek her out and sit in her home and talk to her. But she still had to be submissive to her husband. If the priest and Shaphan and all these men asked, hey, can you come with us to the palace? She would have to ask her husband first. Not just get up and leave. Baby, I'm hungry. Can you cook me something to eat? The Spirit of God is on me. I can't cook you nothing to eat tonight. Figure it out, nigga. That's not how the Spirit of God moves. She still would have to be submissive and say, let me. But I'm serious. That's how women be. They will, just as the scripture said, be submissive, be in subjection to their own husband. We'll run to Bishop Porkchop, right? Tuesday afternoon to do some random thing for him. But your husband asked you to do something. You won't hearken to his voice. He's your husband. Before Bishop Porkchop, you know, even before you even take his call, you need to be answering to your husband first. Have you even considered asking your husband, is it okay if I go to church tonight?
And what about if I take this phone call?
If I take this phone call, if I do whatever. Mm-hmm. Huldah still had to submit to her husband. And Shulam probably didn't have it going on like that. You know, his father or grandfather, as it says, was the keeper of the wardrobe. I guess that's a pretty noble kind of position. But we don't know if he had it going on. It don't look like he did. But she still had to be submissive. How many women can handle that today? They got some great anointing and great ministry, and their husband is just, you know, he just kind of works at the warehouse. Was she not submitting to him? Juanita Bynum didn't. Who's these other? Gail, I know you got some names, don't you? Give me names of some of these black ministers.
I don't know.
I can't think of any. The only one that come to mind is Juanita Bynum. But she didn't. She was fighting. I remember the story
Amy
coming out.
Trim, isn't she one?
Yeah, she's one.
Yeah. That is a horrible name, first of all. The Trim part, but yeah.
But I remember the story of them fighting at a Starbucks or something like that, getting into a real...
...of a well-known television minister. Juanita Bynum tells Atlanta police her husband, Bishop Thomas Weeks, savagely beat her in a hotel parking lot last night. Fox Eyes' Morse Diggs is live in South Atlanta tonight with the exclusive details. Morse?
Russ, allegations of extreme violence are what's outlined in this Atlanta police report. And when a bellhop saw Reverend Juanita Bynum being kicked out here in the Renaissance parking lot, he came to her rescue. On her website, the followers of Reverend Juanita Bynum know her to be a forceful voice, especially for women. Her TV ministry, expanded to a national audience, stresses empowerment, with men and women sharing a partnership in a relationship. Last night, police say Bynum allegedly became a victim of domestic abuse. Photographs taken by a relative and released to Fox 5 show her injuries, bruises. Police say the incident occurred at this hotel that sits alongside Hartsfield-Jackson Airport. According to a relative, the Reverend Bynum and her husband, who's also a minister, are in the middle of a separation. He asked for a meeting last night, and she agreed to that in the hotel dining room. This relative tells me that that meeting did not go well, and the husband left abruptly. Bynum followed, and a few more words were exchanged in the parking lot, and then things got ugly, according to an Atlanta police report. Juanita Bynum stated her husband, Thomas Weeks, choked her, pushed her down, kicked and stomped her in the Renaissance parking lot.
The bellman that was there at the hotel that intervened because of the...
So bad fight, and this was like months after she got married to her husband, her then husband, Juanita Bynum. I remember seeing that as a kid and like, dang, they fighting? I thought she was supposed to be a woman of God. Like, it was bad. They started in the restaurant fighting, and it led to the parking lot, and I guess he hit her in the face, and it was caught on camera and all types of stuff. She was running her mouth. She didn't conduct herself the way Holda did.
Because she's
clamorous. Oh, you was going that route. She's a mighty woman of God. A mighty woman of God. You know what I'm saying? You can't tell her nothing because the Spirit of God is on her. And she's just moving through the Spirit. When she moves, she's not even touching the floor because the Spirit is moving her to her destination. She's a godly woman and can't no husband tell her nothing. Because she got the anointing on her. Even when she's on the toilet doing the number two, the anointing is just on her so deep. That's garbage. Holder still had to submit to her husband. So who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Even Miriam got checked, didn't she? She ran her mouth and she got checked.
She didn't have a husband
either,
did she?
Yeah, it doesn't say that she had a husband. Okay. Gail, can you grab me the book of Acts, chapter 18, verses 2? And then 24 through 26. The book of Acts, chapter 18, verses 2, and then 24 through 26.
Acts, chapter 18, verse 2. And found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome and came unto them. 24 through 26.
So just in that verse, you're seeing that there's a man, Aquila, who's a Jew, right? Coming from Italy with his wife Priscilla. Okay? Read on.
Verse 24. And a certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexandria, an eloquent man, and mighty in the scriptures.
Seleucia, Alexandria being in Egypt. This is one of the Greek empire, Greek towns within the New Egypt, Alexandria. Read.
A mighty man in the scriptures came to Ephesus, verse 25. This man was instructed in the way of Yahweh, and being fervent in the spirit, he spake and taught diligently the things of Yahweh, knowing only the baptism of John, verse 26. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue, whom when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them and expounded unto him the way of Yahweh more perfectly.
Okay. So this is what I want to take a look at. So like I said, before I really start reproving with the scriptures, the women and how they need to be quiet, I first want to bring out how the Most High God can use women. Okay. So you're seeing that there was a man, a fervent man in the spirit, whose name was Apollo, who was also a Jew. Right. But all he knew was the gospel of John. And so all he preached was the gospel of John and the baptism of John. But Aquila and his wife Priscilla encountered this man in the city of Ephesus. And when they saw him, they're like, man, this brother, you know, he doing all right. But he's lacking because he doesn't know the gospel of Christ yet. He don't know the baptism of Christ. So it says, read verse 26 again so you can get some clarity here. Because remember, Aquila and his wife are there in the city and they encounter Apollos. And let's see what the scripture says about how this married couple dealt with this man.
Verse 26. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue.
Meaning Apollos.
Whom when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them.
They took him unto them. They, meaning man and wife, took this other man unto them. Right. So brought him into some quarters where they can sit down and open up the scrolls and do what?
And expounded unto him the way of Yahweh more perfectly.
Why? If the Most High God wouldn't use a woman. Right. Then why didn't it just say Aquila? And he spoke unto Apollos and expounded unto him more perfectly. But the scripture don't say it says they. Meaning Aquila gave his word and the spirit moved on his wife and she spoke to the man and gave him a word as well. Now, some brothers might say, nah, brother, that's off. You reading that out of context. That's what the scripture is clearly saying. Now, let's keep this all within the context of this lesson because the topic is hush, ladies. So women have perverted the gospel. But before I get into the reproof, I want to first show how God can use the woman. When she's in order. Is this woman by herself and going and encountering Apollos? No, she's with her husband. She's with her husband. She didn't come out in some spandex shorts and a skirt. Talking about, hey, Apollos, you preach good, but let me give you some more. No, it wasn't none of that. That brother would have been like, where your husband at? Well, husband, I'm anointed. You better go sit your behind down somewhere. Yeah. But she was, you wanted to say something?
Yeah.
Hold on real quick. But she was submissive to her husband and they sat down and taught this brother. Both Aquila and Priscilla. They both had a word of understanding and knowledge that they could give unto Apollo so that he may have a greater understanding of the gospel of Christ. Yes.
And I'm sure that Priscilla had her hair covered as well. Not just not wearing spandex pants and not just her head, her husband being with her. But also her having her hair covered, as it says in one of the earlier scriptures.
Okay. So, two more scriptures, will we be done? Jonathan, can you give me the book of Judith, chapter 8, verse 11? You have Judith in your Bible, right?
Yeah.
I
should
have, right? Gail, you just get Acts 21. That's the last scripture. So, the book of Judith, chapter 8, verse 11. Chapter 8, verse 11.
Judith, chapter 8, verse 11. And they came unto her, and she said unto them, hear me now, O ye governors of the inhabitants of Bet-Ula, for your words that ye have spoken before the people this day are not right, touching this oath which ye made and pronounced by between God and you, and have promised to deliver this city to our enemies, unless within these days Yahweh turn to help you.
Okay. So this is our foremother Judith. In her wisdom and in her cunning, it doesn't call her a prophetess, but she moved with the spirit to speak unto the nobles, the leaders of our people, okay, during the time in which the enemy sought to come against the nation of Israel, right? And this woman, in her wisdom and in her cunning and being moved of the spirit, doesn't say necessarily she was moved of the spirit, but what she said was wise, and wisdom is only through the spirit. So through her wisdom and through the spirit, she told them plainly, y'all off. Y'all are off. The counsel that you've given is not right. It is not right. And furthermore, she goes on to elaborate that not only is it not right, but it's walking in fear. You're not walking in the faith of God. You're walking in fear. Y'all are so shook by the enemy, you scaring the people and saying, let's just do this and do it this way. No, God will fight for us. If we keep his commandments and trust in him, he will fight for us and defend us. And the brother's like, she right, man. She right. Okay? So you're seeing the example with Judith. She spoke unto the men, but not running her mouth, but when the place was given unto her. If I'm not mistaken, early, let me see if I can find it here. Let's see. Can you read verses 7 to 9, Jonathan?
She was also a goodly countenance. She was also a goodly countenance and very beautiful to behold.
Judith, that is. So she was fine. The woman was fine. Okay, read on.
And her man Manasseh had left her gold and silver and manservants and maidservants and cattle and lands, and she remained upon them.
Salakia, so not only was she beautiful to behold with your eyes, she was wealthy, very wealthy, because her husband, she's a widow now, but her husband was very, very wealthy. Read on.
And there was none that came that gave her an ill word, and she feared God greatly.
So there's none that gave her. So not only was she beautiful, not only was she wealthy, but she had a reputation among the people as being a virtuous and faithful woman who feared God greatly. She was a godly woman. She was intelligent. She knew how to invest and maintain her wealth. She didn't go poor after her husband died, but maintained the manservants, the women servants, and cattle, and the gold and the silver. It takes wisdom to do that. It takes wisdom to know how to deal and how to have those who are investors about you so that you maintain your wealth. But then she was a godly woman, and nobody said anything bad about her at all. Read.
Now, when she heard the evil words of the people against the governor, that they fainted for lack of water, for Judith had heard all the words that Uzziah had spoken unto them, and that he had sworn to deliver the city unto Asher after 5 days.
Okay, read 10 and then 11 again. I'm sorry, just read 10 and then go into 11. Read it again.
Verse 10. Then she sent her waiting woman that had Slakia. Then she sent her waiting woman that had the government of all things that she had.
So this woman, Judith, didn't occupy her mind with how to maintain her wealth because she was a woman given unto fasting and prayer continually, right? So she had a woman that she appointed over her wealth. It's kind of like Potiphar and Joseph, you read about in Genesis. It said that Joseph was over everything, that Potiphar didn't know what was going on besides the food that was on his plate. That's all he knew. Joseph, what's for breakfast here, my master? All the millions that Potiphar had in his bank account, he didn't even know. So that's how much he trusted Joseph. He was such an eloquent and intelligent and resourceful and meticulous servant that Potiphar just placed all of his trust in him and thought, he can do me no wrong. And I'm sure this woman, this waiting woman, had to be an intelligent, godly, and laborious woman, industrious woman, so that Judith could spend her time on fearing God and let this woman take care of the daily tasks of maintaining my wealthy estate. Okay? So Judith, with all her wisdom, is hearing the reports of the things that are happening to her people.
and saying that this ain't right. Read on.
Then she sent her wedding woman that had the government of all things that she had to call Uzziah and Habaris and Hermas, the ancients of the city.
Verse 11.
And they came unto her, and she said unto them, hear me now, O ye governors of the inhabitants of Bet Ula.
Hold it right there. So this woman was beautiful, intelligent, godly, and wealthy, and had a great renowned reputation, right? When she called forth for the nobles of the city, let's put it like this. If we were to send a letter or make a phone call to the mayor to come to our house, what are the odds that they'll actually come? Out of 1 to 10, 10 being the greatest, what would be the possibility that the mayor would come if we gave him a phone call or a letter, a formula?
A zero.
Okay? They're not coming. Why? Because they're the noble of the city. They have too many responsibilities to waste time to come to your house. But you see what just happened? She sent forth her maid to go and call for the nobles of the city to come to her house and speak and talk with her. And what did they do? They all came to hear this woman. Just like Hilkiah and Shaphan and all the kingly men came to Huldah, the prophetess, the wife of Shalom, and spoke to her in the college of in Jerusalem. And said, we got to hear what you got to say. What sayest thou, O prophetess? We want to hear what you got to say, Huldah. Speak up, girl, what you got to say? Don't you got a word from the Most High? What you got to say? So the same thing when Judith summoned these men, they came. Judith called us? Okay, we'll come. We'll be there tomorrow morning. And they came immediately to hear what she had to say. And she reproved them, and they hearkened to her counsel. They hearken to her counsel. So the Most High God can use the woman, but when she's in order. When she's in order. Okay? Very last scripture, Gail, can you read the book of Acts, chapter 21 and verse 9?
I didn't finish 11.
Go ahead and finish what you got there.
And they came unto her, and she said unto them, hear me now, ye governors of the inhabitants of Bet Ula. For your words that ye have spoken before the people this day are not right, touching this oath which ye made and pronounced between God and you, and have promised to deliver the city to our enemies, unless within these days Yahweh turn to help you.
Okay.
Oh,
yeah. I got this, sir. Can you read the book of Acts, chapter 21 and verse 9? Last scripture.
And the same man had four daughters, virgins, which did prophesy.
So this man gave birth to four prophetesses, four of them. So we're just seeing the example of women who were used of God, many of which were prophetesses who had the office of prophet, who received the revelation, right? So we're going to finish this part of the lesson tonight, and we're going to pick up another day going into the reproof of the women. Because it's not the fact that God can't use the woman. It's the fact that the women have abused the word of God, have stepped out of their role and beginning to speak on behalf of themselves or lie on God. That's what they're doing, lying on the Most High God. And he's not pleased with that. But we're going to leave it there for now. Shalom, family. The soul food topic on tonight is Hush, ladies. This will be part two. Let us get right into the scripture. So, Jonathan, can you grab me the book of Galatians chapter 3 and verse 28? You read this last time. I just want to go over it again. The book of Galatians chapter 3 and verse 28. So last time when I brought out the first part of this lesson, I wanted to focus more on how the Most High God can use women, right, to bring about a revelation or message or to fulfill his will, right? There's nothing wrong with women being used of God for that purpose. The problem is when women, especially black women, begin to walk outside of their role, walk outside of the will of God, and begin to do things that are contrary to scripture and pervert the word of God. So the book of Galatians chapter 3 and verse 28.
There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Yahweh, in Christ.
Okay. So
last time I mentioned that as well, that that latter part, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. That is the mantra of the feminist movement in the Christian church, right? As though men and women are all one in the sense of that God is no respecter of persons where gender is concerned. That's not true. Okay? The hierarchy and the status and the roles that were made from the beginning are still intact. Okay? But when we read 1 Peter, it gave clarity, meaning that the husband and the wife are both heirs together in the grace of life. Okay? It's talking about that the Most High God can use both man and woman. But it does not negate the fact that the man is still over the woman and the woman is to be subject to the man, especially the wife to her husband. You see that all throughout scripture. But this scripture here in particular has been perverted by the Christian church, which has opened up this Pandora's box of feminism in the Christian church, in the Christian order. You're seeing more female pastors, bishops, ministers, evangelists, prophetesses who are coming out into the forefront more today than you have ever seen in the Christian community. Why? Because of this perversion of scripture and the laying aside of the other true laws of God. They have laid those aside. Why? Because they say that Christ came to do away with the law. Okay? But we're going to get into that. So like I said, the first part was to highlight the godly women that were used of God, who walked in their godly order and did the will of God. I wanted to highlight that, show you prophetesses throughout scripture, show you godly women who spoke unto the men and the men hearkened unto them because they had wise counsel. I wanted to highlight that first, compliment the women first. But now we're going to get on the women. All right, because the women, especially the black woman, the so-called black woman in the Christian church, continues to run her mouth and speak her heart and not speak the words of God, and are leading the children of Israel astray. You can see this throughout scripture, and we're going to get into these precepts. So Jonathan from there, can you go to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verses 34 through 40? That is the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 34 through 40.
What's the chapter?
Yeah, you said 14, right?
Yeah.
1 Corinthians, chapter 14, verses 34 through 40.
Let your woman keep silence in the court.
Salaki, if you don't mind, when you go to read, can you just recite one more time what you're reading from, please? Mm-hmm.
1 Corinthians, chapter 14, verse 34. Let your woman keep silence in the called out assemblies.
Salakia. In the King James, it says churches. So I don't know if anybody noticed, but we read a few of these passages before verse 34 yesterday, right? You read verses 29 to 33, which speaks about the spirit, the prophets being subject to the spirit of the prophets, you know, and we were getting into those things. But now we get here to verse 34. Apostle Paul, the very one that many of the Christian women like to lean upon for their liberty in Christ to be able to preach and have ministry and hold offices in the church and to be evangelists and to be this and to be that, they lean on Paul. Salakia, let's pay close attention to what Apostle Paul is saying to how the women are to conduct themselves in the assemblies or in the churches. Read that again.
Let your women keep silence in the called out assemblies.
Let your women keep silence in the churches. Let your women keep silence in the churches. Now, we already determined yesterday that there were women prophets and men prophets. Women prophets being called prophetesses, right? And when these women were truly moved of God and the anointing caused them to speak like Elizabeth, right? For instance, it says that when Mary entered in, that the baby within her womb, John, leapt for joy because he felt the presence of Christ when she came into the room, right? And it says that Elizabeth was filled with the power of the Holy Ghost and she prophesied, okay? So we understand that women have their place to speak when they are speaking and uttering the words of God, because when they do that, then they are the true oracles of God. Right? But outside of that, outside of those instances when they're speaking the words of God in wisdom, the women are to remain silent in the churches. Before this, it talked about the checks and balances of how a prophet and those who receive revelation are supposed to deal with these things. It says here, verse 29, let the prophet speak two or three and let the other judge. I was saying before that this is what Apostle Paul set in as protocol for the churches, so that there'd be checks and balances, not people just standing up. I got a word. Nah, bro. Okay, you speak and the rest of us are going to judge the matter and see if it lines up with the laws of God. If it don't, then you're going to get rebuked. We're not just going to let you run off saying whatever foolishness you want to say. I got a revelation last night. I laid down and went to sleep and I had a vision. And when I woke up from that vision, I felt the Lord was saying that fornication is prosperous and glorious. So I think it's right and lawful to commit fornication. That you don't clap your hands and say, hallelujah, praise God. That's not according to the commandment. But you're supposed to sit there and listen and judge the matter and say, that don't sound in alignment with the Bible. Okay? I don't know what vision you have, brother, but that's not of the Most High God. That's sinful. Okay? But go ahead and finish verse 34.
For it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be in obedience, as also says the law.
Hold it right there. So it's not permitted for them to speak, meaning it is not customary for women to be out in front, holding or leading the charge. It is the will of God that they remain in silence and subjection. Okay, sit there silently and learn in the assemblies. But this is the important part that many Christians tend to overlook, right? The latter part, but they are commanded to be under obedience to a man, as also saith the law. As also saith the law. So when we look at that, we have to ask ourselves, where in the law does it say that women are to be in obedience to a man? You have to go back to the Old Testament. You're not going to find this law or this rule in the New Testament. You have to go back to the laws of Moses, when in reality, this law that Paul is referring to precedes Moses. This is from the very beginning in the garden. Okay, and we're going to get into that in a moment, but read on.
And if they will learn anything, let them ask their men at home.
Their husbands. Go ahead.
For it is a shame for a woman to speak in an assembly.
What? Apostle Paul? You mean progressive Apostle Paul, who set up all of these liberties for Gentiles and Christians to do whatever they want in Christ? Progressive Apostle Paul said it is a shame for women to speak in the church? Whoa, that's not what Juanita Bynum is teaching. That's not what these Christian women are teaching. That's not what these effeminate, progressive, socialist pastors are teaching. They're teaching, girl, you get on out there and you stir up that gift. You got an anointing on your life. You need to be having your own ministry. You need to be having your own church, girl. But that's contrary to what the great apostle said. It is a shame. If you want to learn anything, you need to go home and learn it from who?
Your husband.
And if you don't have a godly husband, then your father. Or an elderly man, when the service is over, go to them politely and see if they will impart unto you wisdom concerning the questions that you have if you don't have a husband. That's why it was important for women to be married, so they can have a godly husband, so that he can instruct them in the commandments of God. It is a shame. You don't raise your hand in the middle of the service and say, hey, hi, my name is Elizabeth. I had a question. That was out of order. That was out of order. But see, what Christians will say today is, well, that's the way it took place back in Paul's time. Things have changed.
I don't see anywhere where that changed. I don't see anywhere where that changed. Okay? Furthermore, you see in the book of Revelation that Christ rebuked one of the churches because of Jezebel and her conduct, which walked contrary to what Apostle Paul was teaching. She was a godless woman. She was a false messenger who stood up and seduced the men of God to go astray and commit fornication and to eat food sacrificed unto idols. You had a problem with her. She called herself a prophetess. She wasn't a true prophet of God, but she called herself so, and people received her as a prophetess, and so they regarded her words and took heed to her counsel. But she was a godless, lawless woman, and Christ was angry with her and with the churches and those that accepted her and allowed her to teach in their assemblies. They gave her place. Go ahead, Jezebel. Go ahead and teach. Go ahead, girl. You got an anointing. This is the folly that took place then and is taking place now. It is a shame for the women to speak in the church. Shut your mouth. Shh. Hush, ladies. Read.
What came the word of Yahweh out from you, or came it unto you only? If any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I have that I write unto you are the commandments of Yahweh.
Hold it right there. So not only does Apostle Paul say this, make this statement concerning the women and their conduct in the churches, now he doubles down and says, if anybody got a problem with it, you better understand that what I just said is the law and commandment of God. I'm not speaking as a man. This is not my male perspective. I'm not being a chauvinist. I'm telling you what God said. This is the way God wants his church, his assembly to be ran. Read that scripture again, verse 37.
If any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual...
Hold it right there. Like a Jezebel, like a Juanita Bynum. She thinks she's a prophet. If anything, any of you think you a prophet or spiritual, you better understand what I'm telling you. Read.
Let him acknowledge the things that I write unto you are the commandments of Yahweh.
Read.
38. But if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. Wherefore, brethren, covet to prophesy, and forbid not to speak with tongues. Let all things be done decently in order.
So the Most High God can move upon men as well as women to speak in tongues and to prophesy. But let everything be done in decency and in order, in accordance to what he just stated earlier in this chapter concerning the prophets, man or woman, and then the women in general in the assemblies. Within those parameters, that's when a woman is allowed to speak, when she's given the place to speak in those certain instances. And then men, when they're allowed to speak in those certain instances, it shouldn't be a circus. And that's what the Christian church has become. A big old circus. What's the name of that famous circus? Ringling Brothers, Barnum and Bailey. That's what the Christian church has become. And the pastor is the ringleader. The pastor is the ringleader of this folly circus. You got the clowns dancing, you got the jugglers, you got the acrobats, you got the lion, the elephant, you got the, and the people are clapping and cheering. That's what the Christian church is. And if I'm not mistaken, I think somebody did a breakdown on it a while ago, but that even that word church, the Greek word church, is associated with the root word of the word circus. I would have to look into that just to confirm it, but there might be a connection there. So, and if it is, then it's just, you know, it's just starting to, it lines up. Because that's what the Christian church is, a big old circus. You don't pay admission at the door, you pay the admission in the middle of the service. The only thing the Christian church is missing is the popcorn. They might start serving that popcorn for communion. The Christian church is a circus. But the scripture is saying, let all things be done in decency and in order. But I want to focus on what was said in verse 34. He says, let your women keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. So like I said, you're not going to find this rule in the New Testament. You have to go back to the Old Testament to see what Paul is even talking about.
Okay, so we're going to go there. Go, Jonathan, now to the book of Genesis, chapter 3 and verse 16. The book of Genesis, chapter 3 and verse 16.
The book of Genesis, chapter 3, verse 16. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In sorrow you shall bring forth children, and your desire shall be to your man, and he shall rule over you.
Okay, so this is the law that Apostle Paul is referencing, and how the women are to conduct themselves and be in obedience. The Most High God decreed, Eve, you transgressed. You went aside and did something your husband did not permit for you to do. But you know what? I'm going to reestablish the order. Okay? In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. Meaning you will be subject to your husband. You will be in obedience to your husband. This is the decree that I'm establishing from the very beginning. As also saith the law. Because Genesis is a part of the Torah, the Tanakh, right? So this is a part of the law. This is the Hebrew cosmology. This is the beginning, but it's also a part of the law. When the Most High God spoke to Adam and told him not to eat of the tree, that was the law. So this decree of God is the law. Okay? From there, can you go to the book of Sirach, chapter 26, verses 13, and then verses 26. The book of Sirach, chapter 26, verses 13 and 26. Again, just talking about the wife, the woman, how she's supposed to be in obedience to her husband.
So verses 13 through 26?
No, 13 and then 26.
The book of Sirach, chapter 26. Verse 13, the grace of a woman delights her man, and her discretion will fatten his bones.
Shalaki, so the grace of a wife delighteth her husband. So meaning when a woman is obedient, it makes her husband happy. And every man can testify to that, whether he's married to her or not. When he got a woman that will actually listen to what he says, that makes him very, very happy. When he asks his woman to do something and she don't do it, and has become impudent and disobedient and does what she wants to do, that does not make a man happy, does not please him. And her discretion will fatten his bones, meaning when she knows how to control herself. That pleases the man. He don't got to worry about her. When he leaves from her presence, he don't got to worry about hearing stories from his boys or hearing stories that she out here twerking and acting a fool. She has discretion. He know that he has a lady, not a thought. He has a lady. He has a discreet, chaste woman, not a whore. Jump down to verse 26.
Verse 26. A woman that honors her man shall be judged wise of all, but she that dishonors him in her pride shall be counted wicked of all.
Okay. Now, this is important to note, because in the Christian church, this is not being followed. This is not being encouraged. You got whole pastors out here, male pastors out here who have congregations full of women. A lot of them young women, you know, under the age of 25, got two kids, don't got a man, sleeping around, not preaching against fornication or anything, but encouraging the women that you don't need a man. I heard Jamal Bryant teach that. I've heard other pastors preach that garbage. Instead of reproving the women, instead of encouraging them to sit down, humble themselves, get yourself a husband to help raise these kids and be a submissive wife and learn the order and commandments of God, they teach them, girl, you go and do your thing. Girl, you go to school. Girl, you get a career. Girl, you start a business. Girl, you go and pursue all your dreams. And leave that marriage thing on the back burner. Teaching women to not only fornicate, but teaching women to use contraception, teaching women to use birth control, to commit abortions, murder against their children. These are the things that the pastors teach. You think God is with you? You're teaching lawlessness. You're teaching the destruction of our community, the destruction of our nation. The commandment was to be fruitful and multiply. But you got pastors out here teaching to have vasectomies and hysterectomies to stop you from producing seed in the earth. That's exactly what our enemies want us to do. Okay? But it says, a woman that honoreth her husband shall be judged wise of all. So when we brought out last time the example of Huldah, the prophetess, she was married to Shallum. We don't know what this brother's occupation was. He might have had a real meager job. He might have just worked the fields. But she had to be subject to her husband, as the scripture says concerning Sarah, how she honored her husband and called him Lord. Right? But that's not what Juanita Bynum is saying. That's not what Paula White is saying. That's not what Joyce Myers is saying. You see how Joyce Myers, that brother be looking, man, he don't look, he look like he don't know what's going on. She up there looking like the Joker with her grin from ear to ear, up there motivating the people. Husband looking all effeminate. Preach, honey, preach. With pom-poms. You go, girl. Looking crazy. He don't say nothing. He just a cheerleader. I know you remember Bible Way, right? Yeah. What's her name? Eula M. Nelson? Mm-hmm. Her husband used to look like a cheerleader. As a kid, I would recognize that. It seemed out of place. It seemed out of order as a kid. It's like, man, she up there as the woman and the man is in the background and he just supporting her. It seemed out of order as a child. The Most High God was stirring me up to see something about this. This ain't right. Attended a Spanish church. The same thing existed there. Short little Hispanic woman up there running her mouth. She's leading the church and her husband just in the background playing the guitar. Very sweet. But that's the problem. They couldn't corral their wives. Their wives were in charge. They made the decisions. When people in the church had issues, you think they were coming to the husband to ask their counsel? If a woman or a man came to the door and they had need of spiritual counsel and the husband entered the door, they say, how you doing? What do you call them? First man? What do you refer to? How you doing, brother such and such? Is your wife home? Well, you know, I can talk with. Nah, I really would like to talk to her. I just don't feel you have the anointing. Okay, so dealing with this scripture here, a woman that honoreth her husband shall be judged wise of all. So a woman that does not honor her husband is judged what, Jonathan? What would you say she's judged as?
As a wicked person.
As a wicked person, regardless to how much of a following she has, regardless of how much of an anointing she says she has, if she does not honor her husband according to the Bible, you're not wise. You're not walking in wisdom. The spirit ain't on you, sister. The spirit is not on you. Oh, well, you do got a spirit, but ain't the spirit of God. Okay? But she that dishonoreth him in her pride shall be counted ungodly of all. And that's exactly what she is. Okay? From there, let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 2. Shalaki, verses 11 through 14. The book of 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 through 14.
The book of Timothy chapter 2, verse 11.
It was 1 Timothy, right?
Yeah. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection.
Hold it right there. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. Now, we're not reading 1 Corinthians again. Just to let y'all know. You know, if it's a Christian, oh, you just read the same scripture. No, this is Apostle Paul writing to Timothy the very same things he wrote in his epistle to the Corinthians. So this was not a fluke scripture in 1 Corinthians. You see that there's a pattern here in Paul's teachings. He's not as progressive as the Christians would have you to think. Hey, just take the law and throw it away. No, but Paul taught to keep the law and observe the law. So not only do you see it in the epistle to the Corinthians, you're seeing it here to the epistle to Timothy. Read it again.
Verse 11. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection.
Not raising your hand, jumping up and saying, I got a word, or, you know, what do you think? Or this is my opinion, or I just feel like, no one cares what you feel or what you think.
That angers the black woman. That angers the black woman because she wants to get her word out. She wants to be heard. She wants to be heard. She don't want to listen, but she want to be heard. But when you tell her, I don't care about what you think, you need to sit down and obey the laws of God, she gonna buck up. She gonna buck up against that. Read.
Verse 12. But I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence.
Hold it right there. Hold it right there. We're going to go to that word usurp. Bear with me. We're going to pull this up. Hopefully, this word is better than it did yesterday. Bear with me. We're going to look up that word usurp. Because that's not a common word that we use all the time. So I want to make sure we have an understanding of what we're reading. Bear with me here. Okay, it showed up. Good. Usurp, to govern, exercise dominion over one. To govern, exercise dominion over one. One who acts on his own authority. One who acts on their own authority. What else does it say? An absolute master. Okay, so let's go back to the scripture. Verse 12. But I suffer not a woman to teach. Suffer, that's another word we don't use very much. If we give it a new translation, we can say, I would have not a woman to teach. Hold up. Whoa. So Apostle Paul, the very same apostle that Christians harp on and take hold of his doctrines and say that he is the banner of Christendom. He's telling you women, I suffer not, meaning I would not want for a woman to teach. Then why in the world we got all these female pastors and bishops and evangelists and prophetesses and all these women out front leading whole churches and congregations? How is that so? How is that so? How is that so? That Apostle Paul, right there. But I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp. What did usurp mean again, Jonathan? You remember?
To exercise authority
or dominion over?
Govern.
To govern. What was the other one that I liked? It said here, one who acts on his own authority. That's exactly what the Christian teacher, bishop, pastor has done. Because God, Christ, or Paul didn't give you that authority, but you found it of yourself and you usurping this authority that was not given you from the beginning. Okay? But I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. There you see that again. He keeps going over that. That's making the black woman upset. That's making the white woman upset, for that matter. That's making the woman in general who flee or who converge upon the Christian church. Sometimes that's her safe haven. She feels like that's her place where she can really be herself. No one will stop her. She has a calling. But the law is saying you need to be quiet. You need to be in silence. And that's a hard pill to swallow. When women, a lot of times from the beginning of them going to church, they've been encouraged, you need to seek out ministry. Not the ministry in the sense of giving alms and being a godly woman, as you see in the book of Acts. Because here's the question you can ask a potential or established female pastor, right? This is the question you can ask them. You can ask them, okay, how many disciples were there in the New Testament? How many disciples of Christ were there?
12.
No, I'm sorry. I meant to say it like this. How many disciples in whole, in general, meaning followers of Christ, were there?
A lot.
No one knows the full number. There were a lot. You can see that in the book of Acts, there were thousands that were brought into the gospel. So there were thousands. And we understand that they were male and female. So we can all agree there were thousands of believers, right? How many of those thousands of believers, which probably thousands, if not many hundreds of them were women, how many of them do we see in scripture were pastors, were evangelists, were bishops?
We maybe see
Did it say that they taught?
No.
No. So when you look at all of that, how many examples do we have of women teaching and usurping authority over men? Zero. Zero. But in the same thousands of men, how many examples do we see in the New Testament of men leading and pastoring? All of them are. Interesting. So you can clearly look at the scriptures and see that it's a male-dominated office. But you're saying, no, I can do this. But none of the teachings of the apostles affirm what you're saying. What did usurp say again? I liked how that defined it. One who acts on his own authority. That ain't what God said. That ain't what the apostles or Christ said. That's what you want.
Can I say something on that one?
Yes.
Usurp. Just like the scripture says, she should not, a woman should not usurp authority over a man. You said the first thing should not govern. What did you say again?
What did it say here? To govern, exercise dominion over one.
On her own self, right?
Yeah.
That's where the problems have come into the homes, where the man is not there and the woman is governing. She's usurped authority over the home, so that gives her that approval,
yeah,
self-approval to do
all of that. Everything is topsy-turvy. Now the commandments teach that the woman be in subjection to her husband and follow her husband, but she's departed from her husband. She's listening to another man who's discouraging her from trying to be with her husband and follow him. And that's why you see all of these sexual scandals in the Christian church, because you got a man who either is single or married and got all these little side chicks. And women, you know, just in the makeup of a woman, she likes men with a certain authority, a certain clout or status. And to know that she can get close to the pastor and the leader of the church, that make her feel special. She don't care that he's married. She don't care that he's married and got kids. Especially if he giving her the stank eye. Hey, sister. Sister Charlene, how you do? Praise the Lord, Sister Charlene. God has blessed you, I can see. Praise God. Let me bless you with a holy kiss. You know what I'm saying? This is the mentality. So when you have pastors that are teaching this, leading the women astray, encouraging them not to follow their husband, but to follow them, then you're creating this sort of system of lawlessness and godlessness. And the women are being encouraged to speak, not to be silent, but to speak and speak loudly. And any man that challenges that woman will face the wrath of the Christian church. Any man that stands up and challenges and defies the black woman or the woman in general who is leading a congregation will feel the wrath of the Christian church. When them brothers stand out there, because IUIC got their holy war, their church blitz. They're standing outside of the Baptist church, the Pentecostal church, the apostolic churches. And they're rebuking these churches on Mother's Day, on Memorial Day, on Father's Day, which is tomorrow. They're rebuking them. Right? And you got these pastors coming out there, the women getting upset, standing in the prophet's face and wagging their finger and saying this and that. Brothers who got to be held back like they're going to fight. You ain't going to do nothing anyway. You know you're not. You got whole deacons coming out there brandishing their firearms. Like, bro, you going to shoot me? Because I'm reading the Bible? No, but you need to move off this premise. Bro, we not on your premises. We're on public property. We know the state laws. We know the municipal laws. We are on public property. We're on the sidewalk, or we're standing across the street. Now, if drug dealers were standing across the street selling drugs, you wouldn't say nothing. You wouldn't say a word. If you had hookers, prostitutes lined up, and you had a fleet of cars of, what do you call them, Johns, right? And tricks getting in their car to go and service these men, a whole prostitution, a strip, you wouldn't say a word.
these catwalkers walking up and down the street in a harlot's apparel, you wouldn't say anything. You would say, honey, let's hurry and get in the church.
They wouldn't
try to save their soul. But when you got brothers that have a concern to come and stand and reprove you and admonish you and to bring you into light of the truth, then you want to get buck wild. Okay? Read.
Verse 13. For Adam was first formed, then Eve.
Hold it right there. For Adam was first formed, then Eve. Without really even saying it, Paul is bringing out a very powerful principle. A very powerful principle. Because he just said that I would not, that a woman to teach nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. And then he immediately says, for Adam was first formed, and then Eve. Meaning Adam comes first. Meaning the man comes first, then the woman. She's second class to the man. Plain and simple. But the Christian, oh no, that's not my Jesus. No, that's not the gospel. You're preaching a chauvinistic gospel. That's what the Bible says. No, you're taking out of context. When I read in the NIV, it says something different. Yeah, because that's a perverse, progressive doctrine. That's not what the intent of the apostles. That's not the intent. They're changing it to go along with the sign, with the times. Read on.
And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived was in the transgression. Notwithstanding.
Now, just the 14. Okay. It's locked here. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived was in the transgression. So what is Apostle Paul saying? That if Adam was first formed and then Eve, then he's saying that the man comes first and then the woman. Then he after that says it wasn't Adam that was deceived. It was the woman, the weaker vessel. When the man or the authority was moved out of the way, then the woman who'd had no guidance fell into transgression, not the man. That's why I don't want woman teaching and usurping authority over the man, because they were not designed to lead in that way. They were not designed to do so. The men were designed to lead. That's why Adam was formed and then Eve. If God purposed for women to lead in the way that man could lead, then he would have made them at the same time, or would have made Eve first. But he did not. Adam was made. He was given his name. He was given his purpose. He was given a task and a job. Right? He dwelt upon the earth. We don't know how many days in particular, but Adam dwelt upon the earth and had experience as a living being for however long, until Eve came on the scene. He communed with God and understood miracles and understood the knowledge and wisdom of God well before Eve even came into existence. Adam was first formed and then Eve. And the way in which Adam was formed is different than Eve. Jonathan, how was Eve formed?
From the rib of Adam.
So what is that saying?
That she comes second. She's the side of the side piece of Adam, and she was made to serve or to be a helpmeet.
Perfect. I love that answer, brother. I love that answer. Adam was not formed from the cow. Adam wasn't formed out the tree. He was formed from the clay. And although the Most High did cause Adam to fall asleep and remove the rib and created the woman out of that rib, that was still a part of Adam. But with the Most High, when the Most High God formed Adam, he said he formed him. And then he did what?
Breathe
the breath of life. And he became what, Jonathan?
A living creature. Or
living soul. A living soul. He didn't do that with Eve. Why? Because that living ability was already in the rib. It was already there. Okay? So, we're going to move on from there and go to Titus chapter 2, verses 3 through 5. Titus chapter 2, verses 3 through 5.
Titus chapter 2, verse 3. The aged woman, likewise, that they be in behavior as is becoming in the fear of Yahweh, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things.
Salakia. So we're seeing here that women are to teach. And this is Apostle Paul sending this epistle to Titus. But we just read in the first epistle to Timothy, Paul also said that, let me find it here. But I suffer not a woman to teach. So is he contradicting himself? Because in one epistle, he says he doesn't want women to teach. And then in this other epistle, he's saying that, what does it say? Teachers of good things. So he wants women to teach. Is he contradicting himself? No, he's not contradicting himself, but he's going to give clarity. Read on.
Verse 4. That they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their men, and to love their children.
Salakia. This is what women are to be teaching. Not to usurp authority and teach congregations of men. Not to lead churches and assemblies. Not to do the office of a man, but to teach your women. Teach the young women, teach your daughters, teach your young children. This is your purpose. This is your goal. This is your aim. But unfortunately, you have women, especially the black woman, who's so gung-ho about being in the Christian church and being an evangelist that she's forsaken her true duty to teach her children, to teach her daughters. So you up there, and you the great, powerful, anointed evangelist such and such, and your daughter out here hoeing. Your daughter out here twerking in Wendy's. It has become a shame. Why? Because you abdicated your responsibility as a mother to teach your daughters. How's she 37 and an attractive woman and is not married? That's a failure of the mother. Father also, but the mother. Because you ain't married. You divorced your husband. And now you out here seeking ministry and pursuing all of your dreams. And your daughter is out here not married with four kids. You've imparted unto her godlessness and lawlessness. You're supposed to be teaching her these things. Start back at verse 4 and read down, please.
Verse 4, that they may teach the young women.
Hold it right there. This is what the mother, this is what evangelist so-and-so should be teaching her daughter and teaching other young women. Read.
That they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their men, to love their children.
Salakia, y'all shouldn't be in the club, you know, getting lit, as they would say. Drinking Hennessy bottles. Be sober. Stay off the weed, girl. Put the blunt down. Be sober. Be sober. Love your husbands. What pastor is teaching that? And love your children. Read.
Be discreet. Chaste. Keepers at home.
Whoa.
Good, obedient to their own men.
He said it again. Read it.
That the word of Yahweh be not blasphemed.
Salakia. So when you don't teach these things, guess what you're doing? You're blaspheming the word of God. So when you stand up there, right? Let me see if I can grab this precept real quick to go along with it. When you stand up there and you give the sermon and you preaching fire from heaven and you know you an anointed evangelist and you just an anointed woman of God and all this other stuff, but you're not doing what Titus is talking about, you blaspheme the word of God. All of what you said is for naught. It means nothing. You're not demonstrating this, nor are you teaching young women to do the same thing. Why? Because you're not sober-minded. You don't love your husband. You don't love your children because you haven't taught them this. And then what was the other thing? Verse 5, you're not discreet. You're not chaste and you're not a keeper at home. You out here running from church to church trying to be the biggest evangelist the world has ever known. You out here trying to be the second coming of Juanita Bynum. Keep your behind at home. You trying to network on Facebook and social media and say, hey, invite me to your church. I can... Sit your behind home. Why don't you go back to your husband and try to love him? Well, he no good because he don't know the anointing that's on my life. Shut up. Shut up. God is not using you. You wonder why he want to leave you behind. You know what it kind of make me think about? We watched the Clark sister movie. Mm-hmm. and you saw Maddie Moss Clark and all of her pursuits for her women, for her daughters rather, she was like the female Joe Jackson. I saw parallels between her, his behavior with his children, and her behavior with her daughters. She wanted them to be successful by any means necessary. What she really wanted is for her daughter, she wanted to live her life vicariously through her daughters. That's what it was. She wanted to have the success she could never have on her own. So she wanted to use her talents and abilities and place them on her daughters and use their vocal ability to take her to heights she has never known before. It's the same thing with Joe Jackson and many other parents who push their children to excellence. Serena and Venus's father. That's what they do. They want to push their children to excellence. They want to live their life vicariously through their children. They weren't that good athletically. They weren't that good vocally. They didn't have that success, but I'm going to take what I know and I'm going to make you a star. That is not what Paul just taught. To be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husband, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Okay, but let me find this precept real quick. Let me see right here. Now I got one right here. Psalms chapter 50 and verse 16. So this is to the woman who wants to be the second coming of Juanita Bynum, who's up there trying to teach and preach and have her own DVD series on her lessons and sermons, but ain't doing nothing that Titus talked about. This is what she is. This is what God says to her. Psalms chapter 50 and verse 16. But unto the wicked God saith, what hast thou to do to declare my statutes? Or that thou shouldest take my covenant in thy mouth, seeing thou hatest instruction and casteth my words behind thee. She says, so what business you got standing up in the pulpit trying to preach fire from heaven when you don't keep none of my commandments? You're a liar. You are a hypocrite. A super hypocrite. The so-called black woman in the church leading congregations is one of the biggest hypocrites you have ever seen in your life. She's a walking contradiction. Why? Because she says that she's in alignment with the will of God, but her very conduct and her whole ministry is contrary to the Bible. It ain't no different than a homosexual trying to be a pastor. It ain't no different. It really ain't no different. That's like a homosexual saying that he's born again and filled with the Holy Ghost. It ain't no different than that. You are a walking contradiction. What did you want to say?
I have a precept. I hope I'm not stepping on your toes with it, that you might already have it in your plans.
What is it? Just tell me what
Jeremiah
it was.
Jeremiah 31.
Okay, go ahead.
Jeremiah 31. And 22, based on what you're teaching. How long wilt thou go about, O thou backsliding daughter? For Yahweh hath created a new thing in the earth. A woman shall compass a man. And that's where we are today. O thou backsliding daughter, that won't listen to reproof, that won't allow even the older aged woman to teach them anything. They will curse them out, just like they did on YouTube with Monique talking to them. Yeah. They told her off.
And Salaki, and with Monique, you would think she's the type of woman that women would want to listen to. You know what I'm saying? But it's like you don't listen to Umar Johnson. You didn't listen to Kevin Samuels. You hooped and hollered and praised the Lord because Kevin Samuels was dead. And then Monique, she insisted she always was in defense of the women. Now she says anything to admonish you or check you or try to lead you in the right direction, and you want to tear her asunder.
Mm-hmm. They don't. So that new thing is their pastoring, their bishops, their evangelists, their prophets, their apostles today. They're running their homes and some whatever they're doing.
So you see how in here in 1 Timothy chapter 2, that Paul, when he's laying out the conduct of how the women are to be, because I know you're reading Titus, but when we read in 1 Timothy 2, he referenced Adam and Eve, right? He talked about how Adam was formed first and Eve. And it was Eve that was deceived, not Adam. She was the one that was in transgression. I just want to draw this parallel. So just like you said, now the woman has compassed the man and she's running things. She's in charge. That's similar. You could see the parallel. You could see the similitude between when Adam was moved out of the way and Eve was being deceived. That time period between when she heard the words of the serpent and began to follow him to the point where judgment came and the Most High God approached them, right? That's like what we're dealing with now. Adam is moved out of the way, right? The woman is in charge. And what did the woman do? Once she ate of the fruit, what did she do, Jonathan?
She transgressed the law.
She transgressed the law. But if we're making a parallel between what happened in the garden and what's happening now with the women in charge and leading and doing stuff, what did Eve do once she ate of the fruit? Do you remember?
Oh, she influenced Adam to do the same
thing. There you go. There you go. Very good. So with that being said, if we're correlating that from the garden to the present day, how would you relate that to the woman being in charge? What is she doing?
Controlling the man.
Controlling the man and doing what?
Causing him to go off.
Causing him to go off and the nation as a whole to be destroyed. Yes. It's the very same thing. So it's very interesting that Paul put that in there. Remember what Romans 15 says, that all these things, these examples are for our learning. Things that were written in times past are written for our learning. And we're seeing it being played out. The women are making all the choices. Now we know who's funding this movement, but who are the faces of Black Lives Matter?
Black women.
Black women.
And they're getting exposed out here now.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, I see. They're spending money on this and that or whatever.
Party houses.
Oh, for real? Party houses? Yeah.
Spending money on their man.
Oh, I thought they were lesbians.
Yeah, I thought they were lesbians.
Well, one of them has a baby dad still. And she was buying.
Oh, before she became lesbian?
Before she became lesbian and was buying him things and everything, trying to get him set and straight. A lot of craziness. A whole bunch of houses. Foolishness that's not being used to benefit Black lives that matter, right?
Well, I guess that baby dad, his life, he Black, right? His life matter. But yeah, you're seeing this in all of the important movements. Black women are at the forefront. They're leading it, and society is saying that's what they want, right? That's what society keeps telling us. Keep telling the Black man, this is what you should want. For your Black woman to run you in your community. Okay. We take a step back and we look at it. Okay. I see what the Black woman has done and I'm not pleased with the results. All she has done is destroyed even more what already was destroyed by our own ignorance as men. When we sinned against our God and calamity and curses fell upon us. We already fell in decay. But then the woman came and said, no, let me do it, nigga. And now we've fallen all the way down to rock bottom. But they keep influencing us and saying, no, you're not letting us lead enough. That's why we're not prospering. How much more you want to lead? You already lead our families. Most of the Black families are led by single Black women. How much more you want to lead? And that is the beginning, the infancy of the growth of a family, the growth of a nation. Is the family structure. And if the man is not there, then the woman's in charge. She's leading, she's running. She's influencing her daughters and her sons. How much more influence does she need? You already got the government that is on the side of the woman, right? When the man gets a woman pregnant and then decides to leave that woman and not want to take care of that child, she can take him to child support. The child support offices and the government will cause that man to have to pay and hold him accountable. Either be jailed or whatever fees or penalties will be placed on that man. He will be forced. His wages will be garnished to pay the child support. But what about the Black woman? Don't nobody put that accountability on the Black woman? Is she jailed? Is she penalized for that? No. She's given stipends. She's given welfare. She's given, you know, all types of encouragement to continue doing what she's doing, being whorish. This is what you're seeing. The influence of the black woman is already present, but they still want us to continue to push it. You're just continuing to destroy our family, our families more and more and more. Adam is out of the way. Eve is in charge. She ate, and now she's telling the man to eat, and they eating and all evil. Their eyes are opened. If God didn't step in, what would that world would have become? Well, we already kind of see what the world became once they were removed out of the garden. But being in the holy garden of God, what would have become of his holy garden? That was the garden of God. And Adam was placed there to furnish and to keep it. So if God didn't step in when he did in the cool of the day and encounter his creation, because he knew already what was going to happen. He already had angels that were watching. He was very aware what was taking place. If he didn't step in, what evils would that woman who was in charge now, right? Because if this woman is granting unto her husband a divine understanding that he did not know, right? She was providing him with something that he did not have before. She was enlightened first. So in by nature that he would have to be subject to her authority. Baby, what should I do? Well, I'm feeling the spirit right now. I'm feeling these vibrations. I feel like we ought to do this and do that. Okay, honey, let's do that. If God didn't step in and rectify the situation, everything would have fell into decay in his garden. Right? And we're seeing this being played out. Thus the title, Hush, Ladies. You need to sit your behind down. You ain't no evangelist. You are a whore in a Sunday best. That's what you are. A whore in your Sunday's best. You are not an evangelist. You are not a prophetess. You are not an anointed woman of God. Okay? That anointed oil can very well be baby oil. It don't matter because you're not anointed of God. Okay? So you were in Titus. Did you read to 5?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's move on. Can you grab me the book of Ezekiel chapter 13? Verses 17 and 22.
Can you repeat that?
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 13, verses 17 and 22.
17 and then 22. Can you repeat that?
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 13, verses 17 and then 22.
Ezekiel chapter 13, verse 17. Likewise, son of Adam, set your face against the daughters of your people, which prophesy out of their own heart and prophesy against them.
Salakia, I would like Jonathan to try to answer this. Verse 17, what? We defined a word. What does this verse 17 sound like this woman is doing? It's a word that we defined.
Usurp.
That is the definition of usurp. Why? Because we looked it up and it said, one who acts on his own authority or on her own authority. And verse 7 is saying, likewise, thou son of man, set thy face against the daughters of thy people, which prophesy out of their own heart. Verse 17. And prophesy thou against them. Read verse 22.
Verse 22. Because with lies ye have made the heart of the righteous sad, whom I have not made sad, and strengthened the hands of the wicked, and he should not return from his wicked way by promising him life.
Okay, so this is right here. The prophet Ezekiel is elaborating on what we just were speaking about. The reoccurring of what took place in the garden. Adam is out of the way. The man is removed out of the formula. The women have compassed the men. They're out in front. They have the influence in our communities. The world isn't looking at the so-called black man as the leader of the black community. No, he looks at the black. They go to the black woman. Why? Because she's out there. What black man is at home keeping his family, teaching his wife and teaching his children? You're not seeing that. It's the woman. So that's why they go to the women. In politics, they're influencing the women. In medicine, they influence the women. So like when it came to the COVID vaccinations, they were going to the women, not the men, because they know the women were going to make things happen. When it came to the census, who were they hiring to go and give out pamphlets and flyers for the census? Black women, not black men. Whenever they want a formula to be forwarded in the black community, they go to the black women. We can see that precedent in the book of Exodus. When Pharaoh wanted to bring about his plan of eugenics, who did he contact?
The midwives,
the black women. Planned Parenthood, abortion. Are you going to the men to forward that agenda? No, you're going to the black woman. She commit abortions, commit all sorts of evil and be justified. Verse 22, because with lies ye have made the heart of the righteous sad, whom I have not made sad, and strengthened the hands of the wicked, that he should not return from his wicked way, but promising him life. So if the man moved out of the way, the woman is now out in front. She's leading and influencing our community to do all manner of evil. And nobody challenges her. Nobody defies her. Nobody corrects her. Nobody admonishes her. Nobody does nothing. The woman can do no wrong. The so-called black woman can do no wrong, especially if she's religiously inclined and she sits in the church pews or the pulpit. She's a woman of God. She is a woman of God, and she's leading our people to hell with her godless ways. Okay, from there, let's go to the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 20. The book of Revelation, chapter 2, and verse 20.
The book of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 20. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against you, because you suffer that woman Isabel, which is Jezebel, right?
Yeah.
And this Bible is different. Jezebel, which caused herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce the servants to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols.
So I don't want to deal with that too much because we just went over that. But you're seeing here the evidence of it. Okay. And Christ, the red letter means it's Christ speaking. Right. So this is not an apostle. This is Christ. So this is just layers of that doctrine being established. You already saw several times Apostle Paul in his epistles talking about how the women need to be in silence, be in subjection to their husbands. I suffer them not to teach, not to usurp authority over a man. You're seeing this over and over and over. Let her learn in silence. All of this over and over and over again. And now Christ himself is saying, I don't like that woman right there. Why? Because she is doing everything Apostle Paul taught her women not to do and are seducing my servants. But this is exactly what the Christian church is doing. And this is supposed to be pleasing to God. Don't the women teach fornication? You might say, well, I don't remember hearing Juanita Bynum advocate for that. Well, when you don't preach against it, what are you doing? If you're not against it, then what are you doing?
You know the name of the thing you were asking me about, series with Juanita Bynum? It was No More Sheets.
No More Sheets? What was that about?
To take the sheets off and...
What is that about? Fornication? No More Sheets?
I don't remember now, but I remember that title.
But can you answer that question for me? If you're not preaching against sin, then what are you doing?
Basically condoning it.
Condoning it. You're tolerating it. So that you're allowing that. Mm-hmm. And then food sacrificed into idols. Yeah, you know the Christian church is into paganism. Their whole religion is. You bring out Christmas and how it's against the laws of God. What does the black woman say? For the kids. It ain't about the kids. Because the kids only do what you teach them to do. Mm-hmm. It's for you. This is what you want. Mm-hmm. So now you dictate to the kids now, huh? When the kids say they want this, boy, sit your behind there. I'm not getting that. But now it's for the kids now, right? Uh-huh. That's what you want. This is the tradition you want to keep and keep going. All right? From there, only four more scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 8 through 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 8 through 10.
First Corinthians chapter 11, verse 8. For the man is not of the woman, but the woman of the man.
Salakia, hold it right there. That's a cut to the so-called black woman. That's a cut. She cut up. Let me read it again. For the man is not of the woman, but the woman of the man. Read.
Did you want me to go down to what verse did you want me to stop there?
From 8 to 10.
Verse 9, neither was the man created for the woman, but the woman for the man.
Praise God. I like the way that sounds. Let me read it again. Neither was the man created for the woman, but the woman for the man. We have to understand this. And again, this is Apostle Paul bringing this out. These Christians is getting cut by Paul. The very one they want to cleave to and hold on to and say we love his teachings, he is against you. The things that you're doing are against the teachings of Paul. Read on.
Verse 10. For this cause ought the woman to have power on her head because of the angels.
Now, what is that saying? She ought to have power over her head because of the angels? Can anyone answer that for me? Okay, go ahead. What you got?
For this cause ought the woman to have power on her head because of the angels. The power over on her head is her husband's rulership or authority, headship over her, so that the angels, which like the fallen angels, came into the women back in the day and took the wives of other men and defiled them and they were lost. But the women came unto the angels.
Yes, that's very good. I was looking to see if I could find that precept that actually goes into that.
Didn't we just read it earlier in Enoch?
Yeah, it feel like we did. I'm trying to see. Bear with me real quick. Let me see if I can find that precept. Yeah, we did read it, but we didn't go over that part, so to speak. Man. Bear with me. Trying to see if I can find it here. What is this about? Yeah. I can't find it. I have to bring it up another time. But yeah, it's going back to the beginning with when the fallen ones came down and influenced the women. But there's a passage that talks about how the women, in so many words, seduced the angels with their, you know, in so many words, conjuring or trying to influence the angels to come down. They took the form of men and came unto these women and chose them as wives, right? Or the same thing going back to Adam and Eve. When Adam, who was her protection, was moved out of the way, that's when the serpent took his plan into action. Why didn't he start to speak to Eve when Adam was present? Because he knew he probably wouldn't have gotten very far. But when Adam was gone and Eve was by herself and she was vulnerable and she did not receive the commandment of God mouth to mouth as Adam had received it, right? She was led astray by the words of the serpent. So this is why a woman needs to have covering over her head because of the angels, so that she's not led astray and misguided. Like Madam Blavatsky, is that her name? Madame Blavatsky? No, it's not her, but she received the Shambhala force when angels appeared unto her, right? And other women throughout time. I'm not talking about the righteous women who received angelic visitation. I'm talking about the godless women who received angelic visitations. Akin to Muhammad receiving a visitation from an angel in the cave, or akin to Joseph Smith receiving the visitation of Moroni the angel about the golden tablets buried in Palmyra, New York. Right? Lawless visitations. When women do not have the covering, then they'll start to, because women are the weaker vessel, that they are more sensitive to those spiritual things. That's why women are more in church than men. Now, there's a lot more that goes into it, but because women by nature are more spiritual, and their sensors are more inclined to the spiritual, that's why they can tend to the children. Women's intuition, they talk about the inclinations of women. A man be laying in the bed, sleep, snoring. The woman can sense her children are in distress and wake up and say, something ain't right. You're like, baby, go back to bed. No, something ain't right. Why? Because she has that spiritual ability. It was designed in her. But when the man is moved out the way, then the fallen ones can send out signals, and her RF frequencies can, you know what I'm saying, touch base with them and start to be led astray. Like, yo, I'm feeling these vibrations and all this other stuff, and want to pray and bring forth incantations and all this stuff. And she getting all to this foolishness because there ain't no man around to tell her, yo, you need not do that. You see this throughout scripture. This is what the women did. When the men fell aside and weren't in their role, the women felt, I got to take over now. I got to lead the charge. And I got to lead my family by any means necessary, even if that means witchcraft. I'm going to do what I got to do. That's the mentality of a woman. Okay? Was that all?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's get 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 14.
And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light.
Okay. So when we think about, bear with me, let me just go back real quick to 1 Corinthians and read what we had there.
I was watching this video talking about the Pope.
Speak up a little.
I was watching this video talking about the Pope and how he's like, you know, how he has the white robe on, and how he's supposed to be pure. Everybody worships him and bows down to him. Even the presidents do it, and all of them. And in the video, they were saying that he's like the closest thing to the devil, because the devil was like the bearer of light, and the Pope is supposed to be like that bearer of light, you know, in the all white robes, and how everybody worships him, and he has this much power to. They even say that the Vatican, I mean the Pope, has the authority to actually like say who goes to heaven and who can't go to heaven.
He's the vicar of Christ, so he's supposed to be pretty much the incarnate version of Christ. Christ is in heaven, his spirit is in heaven, but part of his spirit came back, and he's in the form of the Pope.
He's the devil.
Yeah, he is the devil. But what I wanted, will you finish with your thought? Mm-hmm. Okay. What I wanted to get from what you read before in 1 Corinthians was verse 10. For this cause ought the woman to have power on her head because of the angels. So when the man is moved out of the way, then the women are vulnerable, and the angels can send forth their frequencies. Mm-hmm. They can send forth their frequencies, and they know that the women are sensitive to those frequencies. They know it. With the man there, there's that blockade. Like, dang, I can't get in. There's a strong man that blocks the door. I can't get in. But when the man goes off to work, then she's vulnerable. Then you can knock on the door. Hi, ma'am. Would it be all right? And you can come on in. She'll invite you in because she's welcoming and loving. Oh, come on in. And you can rob her. You can kill her, rape her, do whatever. But the strong man not there. I want to say something. Go. go ahead, and I want to make my point. Go ahead.
This is kind of besides what you was just talking about. I mean, this goes back into what I was saying with the Pope. Did you even know, did y'all know that the Vatican, what it really means is the worship of serpents? That's what that word means?
No, I didn't know that.
That's what Vatican means. Mm. The worship of serpents.
Yes. So just with what you're saying, you remember that man that we watched? I think I sent you the video where he was saying that the Christian church, which is under Catholicism, mm-hmm. is Satan's church. Mm-hmm. That kind of corroborates that. Not kind of, it does.
Yeah. What I wanted to say was, now you're aware of the incident that took place this week at my job, right?
Yes.
Where the employee, white guy, comes and robs a black woman, right? Now, just going with the parable of when the husband, the strong man, leaves and goes to work, then the woman is made vulnerable. Someone can come knock at the door, and because she's so sensitive, her sensors are open, she'll just let the man in, and he could rob her, rape her, do whatever, right? She doesn't have the same mind as the man. And the thief, the enemy, knows that. He knows that. But I want to just correlate it to what actually took place. So this employee visited the tenant maybe a few weeks ago to do some call in her apartment. Mm-hmm. And in conversation with him, she let him know that she goes to work at night.
Really?
That's how he knew to case her apartment and wait until she left for him to go in there with the master key and rob her. Mm. Okay? Now, this also made me think about something Quintari said to you when we were down in Raleigh. Mm-hmm. That when one, what was it? Yeah, it was the apartment maintenance guy or somebody, right? The apartment maintenance guy saying something to you and you was like, yeah, and usually I'm not home or whatever. And Quintari immediately got on you. Don't say that. Don't ever say that. Why? Because that's the mentality of a strong man. When you're standing there to protect the home, there are certain things that a man does. That's why they were designed to lead, not the woman. You out there, hush, ladies, there you go. You talk too much. So you out there giving this information, unsolicited, by the way.
Right.
For you, it didn't cause that harm. But for Miss Virginia, it did. And it came back to bite her in the butt. Okay, but it says that the covering should be over the woman for the angel's sake. Then when we get to 2 Corinthians, you still got that? Read that scripture in 2 Corinthians.
What was that, verse 3?
14.
11 and 14. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light.
Okay, so these angels, these fallen ones, these demonic entities that can influence a woman can appear godly. Can appear as, you know, innocuous. They can appear kind and angelic, but they're really devilish and ungodly. But when there's no man there, there's no covering. So Miss Virginia thought Jeff, who's the guy that ended up robbing her, thought, and she always speaks like, oh yes, young man, you're such a sweet young man and you did a wonderful job, young man. That's how she always just call you, young man. And probably thought the same thing. Oh, young man, you're so nice and kind and all of that. And he came around. Yeah. Not knowing that he was a devil that the Bible speaks of.
Y'all ever heard of this guy named Vocab Malone?
Yeah. He's the devil that the Bible speaks of. Vocab Malone.
I was watching a video from him yesterday. He just hate Hebrews so much.
Yeah.
He tried to cover it up like he don't.
I know, right? From how he be talking, right? Like, cause he knows so much about him. It's like you're obsessed with them.
Yeah,
you really are. You wish he was one of them.
Yeah,
that's what it is.
He try to rap. He try to do these comedy skits. He's corny. He's whack. He know his judgment is nigh, but he get into it with Sakari, all the camps, all of them. Mm-hmm. He show up and try to preach, and him and his whole crew, other white dudes and other black apologists.
Black women.
Yeah. Black woman.
Go to IUIC's place one time, but they didn't give him too much,
yeah.
And then they walked.
Because they already know what he about. Mm-hmm. Do you remember when I was telling you that in the NFL, you got brothers who are awakening, right? And you got some former NFL players who were sitting down with some of the players, and you know, coming into this truth and teaching them and bringing them to their house or having talks in a locker room or whatever and bringing up this truth. And there was some report with the NFL was saying that the NFL chaplains, you know, these guys who are designated as interfaith individuals to try to minister to the teammates and the players in the organization, whatever, that they were getting a lot of resistance from the black players because a lot of them were hearing this truth. That we're the Israelites and the chaplains don't have no response to it. And so the NFL was considering hiring Vocab Malone to go and try to speak to these Israelite NFL players to try to convince them that what they've heard is the cult-like teachings. Trying to thwart the gospel of Christ and make us think that we're a hate group. Okay. We almost finished. Can you grab me Galatians chapter 1, verse 8? This one, and then another scripture, and we'll be done.
Galatians chapter 1, verse 8. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you, unto you, then that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed.
I'll read it again, please. Yeah.
But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed.
Okay. So whether it be the angel Moroni or whether it be Juanita Bynum, if they preaching anything that's contrary to what we're teaching, and again, this is Apostle Paul who was talking about the women being in silence, being in subjection to their own husbands, you know, not usurping authority, teaching godly things to the women and being in that role. If anybody come teaching you anything contrary to that, let them be accursed, like Jezebel. I don't care if they say they are a prophet. I don't care if they say they're an angel. I don't care if they say they're God themselves, like Father Divine and his foolishness. Let them be accursed. Okay, last scripture. The book of Sirach, chapter 34, verses 5 through 8. The book of Sirach, chapter 34, verses 5 through 8. Last scripture.
Book of Sirach, chapter 34, verse 5. Divinations and soothsaying and dreams are vain, and the heart fancies as a woman's heart in travail.
So, Lockie, hold it right there. So, divinations, soothsayings, and dreams are vain. These usually, now the dreams aspect, that's not necessarily of witchcraft or dark magic, that can be of God as well. But what he's referencing are the dreams that are not of God, right? When you have carnal dreams, right? Carnal visions, as well as divination and soothsaying, these are vain. These are not of God. They do not profit, okay? And the heart fancieth, meaning usually these certain things, when people go to psychics and go to those who are clairvoyant to try to receive a witch, to try to get some sort of revelation, it's always for their own self-benefit. You understand that? Mm-hmm. And it's the job of the clairvoyant one to give their customer something that will get them to pay the moolah. That's what it's about. You're not going to go to a psychic. You're not going to go to psychic to have them break out them tarot cards and say, it looks like you need to keep... Let me read your palms. You break in the commandments. You need to read the commandments and obey the living God. Mm-mm, girl, I didn't ask you to tell me that. I want to know if I'm going to get this raise at my job. I want to know if I'm going to get that husband. I want to know if my life going to be better. And that's exactly what they do. I'm looking into my crystal ball. I'm feeling vibrations right now. Let me see what your tarot card. Let me tea leaves in your palm. Let me read. It looks like you're going to get that blessing, girl. Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. And if you come back next week, I'll have another revelation for you. They are vain. Just like the David Paul crusade when they were showed to Rochester. John, do you remember that? Did you go to those?
No.
He did? Man, you were lucky. you were lucky.
David Blaine was actually, well, I heard he was like one of the better magicians.
Not David Blaine.
Oh, who did you say?
I said David Paul Crusades. He was a white Christian pastor who would have revivals and come each year.
Y'all were young enough to go, but I
David Blaine. I don't know David Blaine.
I would not even be paying attention. That would be the worst time of my life.
Yeah, exactly. But we were dragged to church because the loud black woman, I don't care if it's my mother, loud black woman dragging the children to church, no man there, no instruction, no guidance, and leading us astray, and let the devil sit up there and tell us lies. So he'll preach for 3.5-4 hours about some foolishness.
Wait, is he the one that looks kind of like Indian?
No, not Benny Hinn.
That's Benny Hinn. Yeah,
no. Okay. He was a straight up white guy, kind of the Rod Parsley, kind of a charismatic white Pentecostal type preacher. That's what he was. Praise the Lord and God will speak to you. And he was that type of guy. So he up there for 4 hours preaching. When he in the congregation, because they usually have what, the Riverside Convention Center? Yeah. It'd be filled with what, Gail?
Women.
What kind of women?
Black women.
Black women. He knew how to work the audience. He was a white man in front of a multitude of black women who were prepared to pay their tithes and offering. So when he got done preaching for 4 hours, then he would spend 2 or 3 hours laying hands and giving false prophecies. Yeah. That's why it says, and dreams are vain. And the heart fancieth, meaning, ooh, I like it. The women would stick around just so in the hopes that David Paul would lay hands on them and give them a false prophecy. They hoped for it. They would give top dollar. Please prophesy for me. Please throw their panties up on stage. Okay, that part I made up. But it sounded like something they might do. But go on. What you going
to
say?
I was just going to say that there was, whenever he would be coming to town, he would send you a letter ahead
yep.
of time. And it would be a part that you can send information on you to him.
Mm-hmm.
So I think a lot of the women, I'm not sure, I know I never did, but because I did get those letters as well, but I never sent those responses. So I wonder if some of them sent information about themselves. So when he called on them, not to mention the fact that I do believe in the what is that
thing? Mystical.
The mystical aspect of it, which is that
Shambhala force?
Yeah, that force could have been at work as well, but I think that he was calling on a lot of people that had sent the information to him as well.
All right. But, yeah, so it's the heart that fancieth. So when you got them letter, and I remember seeing one time the letter came in the mail, like, yo, I hate this, because it was traditional. It was like from when I was like 9 to 10 to about 14, within that time span, every year on point, it was like there was signals, yo. I would come home from school. Whenever I come home from school, my mom had a big pot, a lima beans, or something cooking on the stove. I would always be like, dang, why is she cooking so early? And then I started to look around, and she's getting dressed and ironing her dress. No, please. No. Craig, get ready because we're going to church. No! That nigga here again. I'm sick of this dude. Dang. David Paul Crusades. And we had to be out by 5 o'clock and go and find parking and go up in there and have praise and worship. What's the song they sing? How'd it go?
Blessed be the name.
Yeah, there it go. That's blessed it, y'all. The Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. On high. They would be singing. I'm like, I can't stand this, man. I got to get out of here, dog. I got to get out of here.
And it would take me so long to come out to start the service. Because they would be singing.
They would be singing that song hard, bro.
Sitting up waiting and everything. And it was crazy. I never got called, but you know what I would do? I would say, Father, if this man is really a true prophet, let him call me and tell me something for real about myself. He would look at me, but he would never call me. So I stopped going. I went like 2 times. I would always go by myself. I wouldn't take my kids because it would be during the school night.
Aren't you a kind mother? Aren't you a kind mother? I tell you what, she definitely brought us along, school night or not. And usually it go until like 1 o'clock in the morning. Yes, so we there from like 5 to 1 in the morning.
Before then, I wouldn't.
Bruh, there, we but sit up hearing this white dude go, I will fall asleep. Yo, as soon as this praise and worship was finished, because that's about all I could tolerate, he'd get up there, start preaching maybe 10 minutes in.
I'm dozing off. So that's about 5:36, I fall asleep. Wake up at around 9, 10 o'clock. He's still preaching. He's talking still... That's the million-dollar question. And which kept these black women captivated in these pews. Right? So he'd be preaching. And then, like I said, at the end, he did what the heart fancieth. He did that which the heart fancieth. And then what's interesting here, and he correlates the latter part to a woman's heart in travail. Mm-hmm. A woman's heart in travail. So he correlates it to the woman. What is that like?
A broken hearted woman?
No, a woman's heart in travail. So when a woman is giving birth or prepared to have children, how is her heart feeling?
She won it over.
She won it over with. The thing about it is, for modern day women, there's no joy that comes with the birth of a child. They usually, I just want to get rid of this kid. I wish I never had it. But the ancient women, at the end of the pregnancy, there's the time you had to wait for the pregnancy, and there's the pain and all of that. But at the end is the great joy of the child. That's what it's talking about. So as the heart fancieth, meaning this is what the heart wants. So as a woman in travail, the baby is what she wants, but she got to get past this hard trial to get to the bundle of joy waiting at the end of the pregnancy. And that's what these vain dreams and these vain prophecies that David Paul would give. You send in your money, sister, God has a blessing for you. That's the woman in travail. I want the blessing he's talking about, but I got to get from here, being poor, to the $1 million he promised me. I got to work through that. They're vain. You got women now who still got the mentality and really think, if I send in these letters to Peter Popoff, remember him?
Yes.
Send in your pities to Peter Popoff, that you can get a blessing. And they really, like, legit is hoping on it. And I believe God is going to bless me with $1 million. What? I believe it because I sent in a letter and I prayed and I fasted and I believe God is going to move on my behalf. There's no helping you, sister. There's no helping you. You are bugged out. You are lawless. You do not the will of God. And you think because a pastor said you're going to win $1 million, you think you're actually going to win $1 million? Yes. I don't know what to say. But they make you vain. It's what the heart fancieth. As a woman's heart in travail, she's looking for that baby. She's looking for the prize at the end of the tunnel. And she'll never get it. She'll never get it. Read on to verse 8, and we'll be finished. Verse 6. 34 and 6.
Verse 7. For dreams have...
Verse 6.
Oh, I'm sorry. Verse 6. If they be not sent from God in your visitation, set not your heart upon them.
Hold it right there, because it just said that divinations, soothsaying, and dreams are vain. So it's saying if these things are not of God, don't even set your heart on it. Because that's like what the woman in travail is like. She's looking forward to the baby at the end of this pregnancy. It's 9 hard months she's going to have to endure to get this blessing. That's just like the woman who's vain and hinging her life upon the words of some false prophet or soothsayer. Hinging their life on it. People will go and change their life around just to try to make the words of this witch come to pass. Well, they said it. They spoke it. They read my poems. They read the tarot cards. They prophesied to me. I think it's going to happen. So I just want to be sure to receive my blessing, to receive this gift when it comes. I want to be ready. But if it's not of God, don't set your heart upon it. Don't even concern yourself with it. Read on.
Verse 7. For dreams have deceived many.
Ooh, I like that. Read it again.
For dreams have deceived many.
For dreams have deceived many. Let's get back to the beginning of this lesson. Hush, ladies, which is about the women who are out of order leading the churches, usurping authority. A lot of these women, they're being led of their dreams. They laid down one night. And they had a dream that they were up on a pulpit and they were preaching to a huge multitude of people. And they woke up and said, that's God blessing me and christening me with the dream of pursuing this ministry. What does it say? For dreams have deceived many. Read it.
And they have failed that put their trust in them.
Because these dreams are vain. That's why they're not of God, but they're of yourself. What did usurp mean again? Usurp mean one who acts on his own authority. So you took this vain dream. You got stirred up. It's what the heart fancieth, right? This is what you wanted. It's not of God, though. But you're being led of this dream. You're being deceived. And you're going after it with all your heart. Not doing the will of God, but doing your own thing. Read verse 7 again and then 8.
Verse 7. For dreams have deceived many, and they have failed that put their trust in them. The Torah, the law, shall be found perfect without lies. And wisdom and perfection to a faithful mouth.
Okay. So Juanita Biden, this is what you need to read. Verse 8. The law shall be found perfect without lies. Even what Apostle Paul wrote, that y'all seem to just skip over or just rip, you know, just kind of rip it or didact it, just kind of, you know, put a marker, a Sharpie over it. It's still in there. The law shall be found perfect without lies. Because all of what Apostle Paul taught in his epistles can be found in the law and the commandments. He's not writing something that's so strange. You've seen the conduct of Sarah and Rebecca and Rachel and the godly women and how they conducted themselves. I showed that in the first part of this lesson. These are godly women. But when you loudmouth and you transgress the commandments of God and you're doing things contrary to what the law saith, pursuant to Genesis 3 and 16, that the man shall rule over you and you shall be subject to your husband. If you're walking contrary to that, you're the problem. You're the issue. Okay? So that wraps up our lesson. Again, the topic is Hush, ladies. Shalom, family. Shalom.